Rob, you touched on Nicklas Backstrom as a guy who usually, you know, kind of fades into the background. Ovi's usually the superstar, but he's been the goal-scoring superstar for the Caps through this series with the Canes. He already has five. He had two more on Saturday night, almost had a third late in the game. I mean, what he's done so far offensively, especially with Oshie being sidelined, has been huge for this Capitals team.
It's great. I love that after game one or game two, I guess, was Ovi said, I'm Backstrom now because he's getting all the assists, and Backstrom is scoring all the goals. But Nicklas Backstrom, five goals in this series, which ties his career high for any series. And he's just in a good rhythm right now. I mean, it's how could any Caps fan not love seeing this guy carry the team for a little bit? Again, the guy who's always been the second fiddle to Ovi and is perfectly happy with that is now the guy making all the big plays and still playing a 200-foot game, still being a defensive center first, still winning faceoffs when the Caps struggle with faceoffs all season long. So it's not like he's not doing the other things just to cheat the game and get himself in good position to score goals. He's just doing everything. And, excuse me, it is a pleasure to watch him play the game. Really, again, another guy you just sort of take for granted because, like myself, most of us watch and don't really appreciate all the little things he does during the game. When I get to sit with Alan and he points out 15 different little things that he does during the game, like, my God, this guy, he's just a superstar.
You know, something kind of flew under the radar in that dominating win over the Hurricanes at Capital One was the Nick Dowd penalty shot that he converted on. He was interviewed about it. It was a great, like, look, just like Kuzi's goal against the Pens in Game 6 last year. He kind of channeled Kuzi and went 5-hole on Mrazek. And he was like, I've never scored in one. I've had these opportunities before. I've never converted. He did it on the biggest stage over the weekend. Mm.
That was awesome. It was a sweet move. And we had him on our post-game show afterwards, and I think Locker asked him, you know, if he had a plan. Maybe it was Alan that asked if he had a plan, if that's what he wanted to do. And he's like, no, I just kind of got in and something developed. But, yeah, it was great. And it's funny, we had Brett Connolly's wife and Nick Dowd's wife on our pregame show. They were there to talk about them auctioning off their jackets, and both those guys scored in that game. Which, A, I think every wife should be clamoring to get on our show now, because that clearly was big for those two guys, and it was just big for more guys helping. Dowd has had a really nice series. He's another guy that, you know, accepts his role. He doesn't try to be something he's not. And this is a guy whose, you know, career was sort of in the balance and has had a nice season and found himself a home and earned himself a contract. And it was a great play. The only thing that would have been better than Dowd converting on that penalty shot was if, on the initial shot when it rang off the crossbar and laid there, if Devontae Smith-Pelly had tapped in that rebound, they would have had to build a new arena for the next home game because the roof would have blown off the top of that place.
Yeah, the pop that DSP got when he was on, not only on the ice, just like pregame. I mean, it was thunderous.
Well, I mean, he was so big last year.
Reinserting him back into the lineup. Maybe that's the little spark this team needed. What did you think about that, the reaction he got from the crowd on Saturday night?
I mean, it's crazy, right? Here's a fourth-line guy who was waived, not picked up by anyone. No, every team had an opportunity to take Devontae Smith-Pelly, and they all saw how clutch he was in the Stanley Cup run last year. Not one team wanted him, so he goes down to the AHL because he was having a bad season. And this guy goes down there, and then TJ Oshie gets hurt. A star TJ Oshie gets hurt, and they bring him back up as a fourth liner, and they're chanting his name in the arena. That just doesn't happen. And then he goes out there, and after his first hit, you could tell, I mean, the place went crazy, and then you could tell he was like, this is why I'm here. I have to add the spark, the energy, and he did it. He played a great game, and, you know, it was funny because before he played, I kept talking, like, you know, guys in our crew, I was like, they're expecting this dude to be the savior. I mean, he had 4 goals, he had 8 points. You know, like, let's not put too much pressure on Devontae Smith-Pelly, you know? Like, I don't think he's going to be what everyone's expecting, and then you're just placing unfair expectations on this guy. And then he came out there and just, maybe it was the game and he's getting too much credit, but I do kind of feel like the crowd fed off his energy, he fed off the crowd, and the team just went along. And had he scored that goal, Hollywood couldn't have written that script that this dude gets called up like that.
Right.
And it's such a factor. It was a great story.
Yeah, they definitely fed off that energy for him. But I was telling the boys earlier in the show, I said, look, it was good for one night, and we routed them, and it was no contest. But you're going to feel the lack of TJ Oshie at some point. I don't know if it's going to be tonight. I don't know if it's going to be in Game 7. I don't know if it's going to be against the Isles. But you lose a guy like Oshie, you're going to feel it. And I hope it's not tonight.
I mean, look, that's a huge hole to fill. But I interviewed Carl Hagelin before the game the other night, and I said to him, it was kind of before the interview started, and I was like, you know, I meant to look this up, but quickly off the top of my head, I'm just not thinking about it. Your back-to-back run when he was with Pittsburgh, did you guys lose someone like Oshie? And he looked right in the eye, he's like, we didn't have Chris Letang for the whole playoffs.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, right, you did not have Chris Letang, their best defenseman, for that whole playoff run. No one cared, you know, Caps lost to that team. No one cared that they were missing their best defenseman, and neither did they. They just went out and played. So is there going to be a huge hole to fill with TJ Oshie? Of course there's a huge hole to fill. But no one cares. So if they want to do that again, if Nicholas Backstrom is still as addicted to that feeling of winning the Stanley Cup that he has repeatedly talked about, if Ovi is still addicted to that feeling and wants to feel it again, no one's going to feel bad for them that TJ Oshie is out. So they'll have to figure it out. I mean, the Islanders are tough, and Barry Trotz is there, and he knows how to beat Pittsburgh clearly, and he knows, you know, the Caps better than anyone. But if you lined up all the names with or without Oshie on a sheet of paper next to each other, you go, well, the Caps have the better players. Right up and down the lineup, the Caps have the better players. And Tampa's got, you know, who knows? So they'll have to figure out a way to do it the same way Pittsburgh did it without Chris Letang.
Joined by Rob Carlin, Capital Studio host on NBC Sports Washington. He's brought to you by PVI Office Furniture. Fast, excellent, affordable business grows with PVI. Visit their showroom in Frederick, Maryland, or online at PVIPVI.com today. Rob, do you think the Caps can bring that same sort of physical style with them on the road to Game 6 in Raleigh tonight? I love the quote from Reardon post-Game 5. He said, eventually, if you do it for long enough and you believe in the rest of your systems enough, you will break them. So it sounds like he knows and that the players know that they've got the best of it physically against this Hurricanes team, that they're in their heads a little bit.
Well, they're certainly in Dougie Hamilton's head the other day, because he made a business decision to avoid Alex Ovechkin at all costs, and it cost them a goal. So, you know, that's kind of what they did throughout the playoffs last year. That became their identity, just sort of wearing teams down. And, you know, Ovi is the unique thing, because it's more than human, that just keeps hitting and hitting and hitting and still playing at that level. But, I mean, that's sort of who they are and the identity that they've taken on. And I hope so. I hope so, because Carolina is going to feed off the energy. I mean, that thunderous ovation for DSP and the energy he brought and his hit made the crowd go crazy, and then the goals and the crowd went crazy. But there's still down times at Capital One Arena. Puck's out of play. It's a little quiet in there. People are sitting. The music's okay. It is not like that in this building here. It is loud. It is pumping. The crowd is into it all game long, at least in the two games we were here. I can't speak to how it's been for 10 years while they were a bad hockey team, but the two games we were here last week, the place was incredibly loud, and they scored those first early goals, and it just kept getting louder and louder and louder.